Hey, this is NavaBear, and you're listening to REZOcast.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to REZOcast episode 24. This is Lego, and I've got with me Hove and our special guest, NavaBear. Thank you so much for joining us, man. Just let us know how your week's been in Destiny or other games. You know, I know there's a lot of new stuff out.
Yeah, it's definitely hard with all the new games coming out, especially Switch game starts coming out today, pretty much tonight. Yeah, not getting that, but yeah, definitely hard to just stick to Destiny at the same time. But no, I've been having a lot of fun with it this week. Very minimal, because I will say I've been playing Horizon Dawn a lot. But no, I'm still having fun with this new primary meta. So it's still very enjoyable to me, because it's kind of more or less what I've wanted for a long time.
Nice, yeah.
Regardless of sidearms, but I still really just enjoy going into, especially sixes. It's more enjoyable now that I'm not worrying about shotguns. So I stick into like clash and control way more than I did like skirmishes and stuff like that now.
Nice. Man, I need to try that. I still have been back in my threes and rumble, and I haven't ventured out into sixes as much. But the way what Triton was talking about and the way you're talking about now, I'm really, I only played Iron Banner for a little bit, and that's the only sixes I've done. So, man, I really need to jump into that.
Yeah, it's definitely a lot fun, a lot easier to get a hold of in there now. Not as frustrating.
Nice.
I'll say that.
Yeah, my week has been pretty good. I feel like I've had a change of heart on some of the things to do with the patch. Maybe we'll talk about it later. But I had this feeling after playing Trials that I hadn't got before, which was just like this feeling of like, man, I'm kind of like, after that last game, I kind of didn't want to play anymore. And I never felt like, I don't play that much, like, right, to where I get burnt out like that. And I felt that way. And I was like, whoa, what is this feeling? You know, like, and so I don't know, maybe it was like just because of the more primaries and so many of them. But as far as Rumble and threes, I'm still having a ton of fun with that. Rumble in particular has been ridiculously fun. And even the little bit that I went into Iron Banner for sixes was really fun once I got some ammo. Like, I got Queenbreaker's bow out, just grabbed some special ammo, and just like sat kind of behind everyone and would run away whenever people started coming at me. And I stayed alive for long enough to have like 50 bolts like in the reserve. Like, it was ridiculous. I don't know.
Yeah, but so you get quite a bit of ammo for that weapon.
It was so ridiculous. Hope, how's your week been, man?
It's been good. The last few days have been really busy for me. I actually just jumped onto Iron Banner about an hour before we were recording this, just so that I could play it and see what it was like. The last I played before that was Monday night with you.
Trials?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I also, since you opened the podcast
I
last
the
week
floodgates.
by asking how I let you win in Rumble the week before, how did it feel letting me win this week in our Rumble games?
Lego. Oh my gosh. I don't know. Well, okay. We got to preface that, because what was happening during those Rumble games?
I think I
recall a few backstabs and a few super usages during our Rumble games. I don't know. Do you remember that?
Yeah, that was the game you beat me, though.
So you're you're saying I don't you have to break the rules for me to win. Okay. It was, you know, we had Revenge of Hove, you know, this weekend. And so we'll see what next weekend brings.
No, but in all seriousness, it was, if it was an actual like competitive where we were like serious, I mean, we both wanted to win, don't get me wrong, but it was like the most epic three game series of Rumble ever. And yeah, we always end our Trials nights with a no land fusion only Rumble game with whoever we're playing with. This week it was Wilson by that point.
Wilson, yeah.
And
oh, sounds interesting.
So the first game, after, you know, we talked all our shit the week before, I won the first game in a very close game. So I talked a bunch of shit, of course. So Lego comes out the next game and just slaughters everybody and has a Phantom, and everyone's like, oh, you know, ha ha ho, look, Lego came out. So it was like, all right, we'll play one more, and then I got a Phantom in the next game.
And I could not touch him either. Like, it was like he was indestructible for a little bit until the very end, and I got ahead by one kill.
And literally, with 1 second left, I got a kill in one game.
Oh,
one
nice.
Second.
Oh, it was terrible. It was and amazing.
It was a really good, really, really fun time. But it was just like so epic. Like you were down, you got a Phantom. I was down, I got a Phantom. Like it was the most fun Rumble I think I've ever had. So
it was pretty epic. But before we get more into Destiny talk, let's get to know Nava here, our special guest. We're so glad that you're joining us. Nava, let us know a little bit about what your place is in the Destiny community or what's going on whenever people log in to see you on Twitch.
As far as like my placement in Destiny, I kind of see myself more as like a background person because I do a lot of, if some people already know, like I do my own Twitch, but I'm more known to help other people in their Twitch setups. There's some small time people like KJ Hovey, the Manigator,
who are those?
Fernet Beauty, you know, and then I've also helped True Vanguard, who also lives like 20 minutes away from me.
Oh, nice.
And I do a lot of like their technical support that way. So that's how I see myself. Like, as far as the personalities that are out there on Twitch, I kind of see myself behind them, just kind of helping out and other people set aside their issues. But also, I've been lucky enough to join another bear named Pope.
Yeah.
And meet some of his friends that, you know, his connections at Bungie and stuff like that. So I've been able to hang out with them and get to know, you know, different programmers and engineers. Another really fun guy, Irk.
Yes.
He's great to do raids with. He's just a ball of energy every single time. He sings with us. He does like his own vocal scores when we're doing raids. It's pretty hilarious. So, like I said, it's all like background stuff. Like I'm never like out there in the open. Like I'm not like the big numbers kind of pusher, but there's a lot of people who just know like my name or they've heard people talk about me. Like, well, I've heard of you. So-and-so talked about me or someone told me to come to you. Like Mesa Sean, I've helped a lot of stuff with him, but he'll always have like his viewers or his subs like, come to me with the same questions. And it's just like that. That's how I see myself here. It's just more or less a helper. I'm not like trying to get partnered or anything like that. I just enjoy helping people out.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, especially. And it's funny you bring up Mesa Sean because like thinking back within the recent history, I can remember Mesa Sean or like either asking you something on Twitter or like somebody tagging you and something on Twitter like, hey, Nava, this guy's asking this question, can you help him out? And it's the same thing in our Resolute group meet too. It's always like, oh, this technical thing, Nava, where's he at, you know?
Yeah, I was gonna say, even if it's me asking, if I like, at least with my Twitter feed of who I follow, if anybody asks for any like OBS computer Twitch setups and they know Nava, the answer is I don't know, ask Nava. And he knows. Always. So you were definitely right there.
Yeah. I enjoy doing it. It's very fun when I have the chance. Obviously, it's just time consuming at the same time. So I try my best to help everyone I can.
Yeah, totally understand. Well, as far as Destiny and playstyle goes and stuff like that, where do you feel like you fall in the lines of PvE and PvP?
PvE, I've really kind of fallen off. I pretty much do one raid a week if I do PvE. And that's usually Wednesday nights if I do it. But PvP, I'm not a quote-unquote sweaty player, but I do manage to do pretty well as far as playing PvP. I'm never way below, and if you're going to put the KD, like I manage a 1.5, but I'm just playing. I'm never really trying.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the thing. It's like I do well enough that I'm pretty decent, and I get to match a lot of the skill players. At the same time, I'm not constantly put with them. But I really enjoy PvP. It took me a while, actually, at first to get into PvP. Because when the game first launched, the first 6 months, I was still heavily into Battlefield 3,
yes.
I think.
Yes.
And I was playing Rush. So I actually used to just do the whole shotgunning thing like way before it was a problem last meta.
Oh my gosh.
The bounty was like, hey, go kill 10 hunters. Well, I just grabbed a shotgun and I just ran at 10 hunters and I killed it and got the bounty and then bounced out and went to the next match or what I needed to do. So it took me a long time to actually like play PvP in this game as it is PvP. It used to just be bounties and that's it.
Battlefield 3, man, you're speaking my language, especially Rush. Man, that was my game type. Like, I could load those games constantly and never get bored of it, just the thrill of that. And I feel like coming back into Destiny PvP, I feel like every time that I play with you, you call yourself like an average gamer, but every time that I end up playing with you, I always, for some reason, like play my worst. Every single Trials game I've ever run with you, it's like the worst I've ever played. And I never really talk about it with you or anything. I'm always like, man, what am I doing wrong? You know, what can I do better? But in my eyes, you're really good because every time I go in, I feel like you're carrying me a little bit in some way. So I can appreciate your PvP skills.
Yeah, I mean, we do play, like, a lot of times it's just communication. Like, even if you're down, like, we play with Pope last, and I'm like, just keep talking. Like, and that's, that comes from Rush. It's just, if you tell me information, I play a lot better. So you can tell me the most minute thing, but it'll help me because in my head I'm processing where that person is on a map. Even if they're outside the radar, like, if you're like, oh, he's all right, at least I know on the right side there's one enemy. And maybe on my radar, I see two. So I'm like, there's my count of where everyone's at.
Nice, yeah.
And that's my biggest thing when playing with people is just communication. And Rush was always the thing that brought me to that, because that's where you really did well, was communicating in that game mode.
I'm curious, with Rush, did you normally on I know I'm getting off Destiny stuff, but on whenever you played Rush in Battlefield, did you play with a lot of other people, like, and communicate, like you're saying, like, that information? So when you came over to Destiny, you were kind of used to playing with that many people, or was Battlefield a completely different thing?
No, Battlefield's the same thing, like, a lot of people do here with Destiny, is, like, they come in solo, and then eventually, like, they might open up and talk to one, two, three people, and then eventually becomes a bigger thing. And that's how Battlefield was for me. Eventually I had certain people I play with all the time, like our best tank guy was named Captain Sparkles. So every time we had a tank on the map, we just knew we'd give it to Captain Sparkles, and then people would, you know, switch to engineers, and we just kind of had a whole game set up.
That's cool.
And like I said, from that all that information, like giving and taking, has come from that, and I bring it here to Destiny. So like I said, people I play with, I'm like, just keep talking. I'm like, I don't care if you're dead, but I'm like, as long as you're telling me information, you're going to help out. And it might not help me, but it might help someone else. Like, that's the biggest thing. It's just communication.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think communication's probably, you know, if there's one thing to tell someone to work on in team modes, I think is communication. Because, you know, like, I've played with two players that are much better than I am, that we've never played together before, and we just can't do anything. And then I might play with two people that I play with all the time. We're all mediocre, but we do much better because we know each other's play styles.
Mm-hmm.
We know where we're going. We communicate a little better.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah, I think that's always a big thing. I can't compare it to Rush because I've never played a Battlefield game in my life. I don't know what Rush is, so we'll just move on.
It's amazing. If Destiny got some sort of Rush-type mode, oh, man, I would love that so much. I was so glad when Halo got a mode that was kind of like that. I think it was... It's either Halo 4 or Halo Reach, I can't remember, that got a mode that was like a progression, like of bringing the bomb in kind of stage. I can't remember.
Yeah, I don't remember either.
Which one
so
it
long.
Was. But it was a lot of fun. I love game modes like that. And man, the communication thing, whenever y'all were just talking about that, it just dawned on me just now that, like, all out of all the multiplayer online games that I ever played, like before Destiny, I never really found like that group of people that you're talking about that I have now with Destiny. It was always kind of like, you know, I played with this person here, but I never like befriended someone and kept playing with that continual person other than my in real life friends. And so, like, it's interesting how Destiny has kind of forced so many people to get that kind of relationship with other people and work on those communication skills that if you never, you know, played with other people online really consistently in teams, developed those skills. And I feel like I'm for the first time actually working on, I find myself working on those. Like when I first started listening to Trials Help stuff, it was like all about information, like you're talking about, Nava, and that has helped me like tremendously. I can't even believe that I never did those things before this game, you know. I'm like, wow, this helps a shooter so much just to talk and communicate.
Yeah, no, and the same thing, like I when I was, a couple years ago, I used to work at GameStop, and people would be coming back to buy Destiny for the second or third time, and they're like, and I'm going to give it another try. And I'm like, well, have you actually talked to people besides just your in real life friends? They're like, well, no, not really. I'm like, well, I'm like, give it a try. And I would show them like the websites, like the 100.io was one.
Uh-huh.
And there's a place I'm like, try that. And then, you know, go play and see if that brings more light to the game for you. I'm like, just communicate and learn to talk to new people. And, you know, there's going to be people that you're not going to like. There's going to be people that you love playing with. But it just, you have to take the chance and do that and experience
Absolutely.
Yourself. And I've had people come back when they buy other games when I was working at GameStop, and like, yeah, I love Destiny now. It's amazing. You know, thanks for, you know, telling me about that stuff. And then as far as I know, they still play the game.
Yeah.
Like I said, just they had to open up and just start communicating with people.
It becomes a completely different game once you
open
up, like you said, and find a group to play with. Because, you know, for anyone who's listening to this, my, you know, my experience before finding people in the game to play with was, what's an Atheon? You know, that's where my in real life friends, we ended. I didn't know what the hell was going on. And then, you know, you kind of find some people to play with and the game completely opens up.
Yeah.
Yep.
So what type of games did you come from? You said, you mentioned Battlefield. Were shooters kind of always your thing, Nava, before this, or were there just like a variety of different games?
Pretty much a variety. I mean, because I grew up with three younger brothers, so I couldn't always get the games I wanted to get. So sometimes they'd be like, oh yeah, I want to get, well, I mean, we all had GoldenEye growing up, but yes. I mean, they'd be like, hey, there's this other game for, you know, the 64 that I don't get, but they're like, oh, is it four players? It's like, no, okay. Well, I have to get this other party game then for my brother. So it was always a variety for me growing up, which is great because it's carried over now. So I'll play other games that aren't shooters, and I can have a lot of fun. I know there's some people are like, oh, I only played shooters, but then they go and try something like Horizon Zero Dawn, and it's like, it's not for me. Like, I can't do a single player, like, not PvP-based games. Yeah. Like, I just can't do it. I'm like, well, it's really kind of missing out. But
yeah,
but yeah, shooters have been there all the time, like I said, growing up against my brothers, maybe some other family members. I mean, we still try to do GoldenEye, but it's so hard now on those, like, 64 and 64 controllers.
Oh, man.
And then playing now. But we still try, but none of us are good at it.
One of my best experiences recently was I was playing this gig somewhere that was, like, 3 hours away, and the sound guy who was running it was, like, that night, all the staff were hanging out for the event, and this guy was like, he found out somehow that I was a gamer, and he was like, dude, you got to come into this room like in 5 minutes. And I was like, what is it? You know, I don't know. And I walk in the room, and he's got his laptop set up with a like four USB port thing, and has four GameCube controllers coming out of it, and he has an emulator with Super Smash on it. And they were like, nice. Dude, we're doing a tournament. You got to get in. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. And that was like my last old school experience I had a little while ago. And it was so much fun just sitting in a room with four other people. I want to go back to GoldenEye. I can't even remember what it was like just using one joystick. I can't imagine it right now.
Yeah, it's really difficult. But I still play N64 at least once a year. And that's like Thanksgiving. Me and my brothers, we get together and we do Smash on 64.
Yes.
So that still goes, even though some of the characters are broken, and they're like, yeah, the moves are fine. I'm like, whatever. It's still a lot of fun. It's hard to do, and our controllers are falling apart because they've been the same for 10 years right now. But it's still a lot of fun.
Yeah, there's no no hot fixes for that game anymore, huh?
Yeah, no. There's some moves that you want to really call like invincibility frames. There's some characters that they can get out of anything just by doing a certain move.
So Nava, with being involved in the community and stuff, I just want to run over just briefly just some of your favorite moments. It can be within Destiny, the game, or outside. You know, it can just be you know, maybe it, like helping another community member out or something like that. I just wanted to see if you had any favorite moments that have stuck out with you. You know, since maybe Destiny era, you know, what has stuck out with you as some of your favorite moments? It can be one or a few.
Some of my favorites, I have to go with, I guess, my first time playing with Mesa Sean, because that's the first time I learned about, like, how to share my voice, because he was first starting to stream, at least the Destiny, as far as I knew, because I used to watch his videos and stuff like that. And then I just happened to be watching him, and he invited me in to play, and he was like, hey, the chat wants to hear your voice. I'm like, well, how do I do that? So he had explained to me how that goes and how do I do that for my PS4. So playing with him, because then it became a regular thing almost a couple weeks later, where I'd help him and some viewers like go through the Vault of Glass, that type of thing. And then that led me to meet up with Tinx. And then another favorite thing came later with after meeting Tinx was me, her, and a former Rezo member, Sugar Shag. We used to get together on Thursday nights, and we would do Triple Bubble, and that was just three Defender Titans doing the Nightfall. So that was back when it was hard and no one really knew how to use Defender Titans. So we just goofed around, and it was pretty much like me being the serious adult, and then Tinx and Sugar Shack just being complete like children playing this game, jumping around, and I was always trying to like save them. It was frustrating, but it was fun, and I think everyone really enjoyed it.
That's awesome. That's so cool. Yeah. I love moments like that. It's funny, you were doing the Defender Titan before DFP made it cool.
I guess, like I said, it was just kind of an idea that Tinx wanted to try, and yeah, we kept it up for several weeks. There's old videos on her channel for that.
Yeah, I would say back
They're
then
hilarious.
It was,
I go back and watch them.
It was, hey, let's try this, and now it's, you know, people be like, God, you're running three bubbles. You're so sweaty. You're cheating.
Yeah. But you know, it's definitely fun to do that. Like I said, back on the old one, it's like you messed up and everyone died, just back to the beginning.
Well, as far as current day Twitch stuff goes, because you do stream, and so I was wondering what if people were come to your channel, what would they find you doing typically on your own stream?
On my own stream right now, I'm doing a couple like different variety things, not just Destiny purely, because Mass Effect Andromeda is coming out, and Mass Effect is one of my favorite series to play. So I'm redoing that. I'm actually halfway through Mass Effect 3. So I want to finish that before Andromeda comes out. Horizon Dawn has come out as well. So I've been at least doing the first couple hours streaming that. But as far as Destiny is concerned, I do that. And I do a lot of sixes, and I will invite viewers in as well. But the thing is, I'm not on, let's say, during daytime. Mm-hmm. So I work second shift, so I don't get out of work until 10 o'clock p.m. like Eastern. So I get home, you know, make dinner and all that kind of stuff. So I won't start streaming until midnight, and then I go until like 5 in the morning if I want a long stream.
Yeah.
So sometimes that's a little bit harder for people, like, well, like, I see you went live, but like, when'd you go? And I was like, well, I start at midnight and go until 5 in the morning Eastern time. Like, oh, okay, like, I'm already asleep. I'm like, yeah, I know. But I'm like, I want to keep streaming, you know, even if that means like it's just me and Nightbot for a couple hours and then people roll in.
Nice.
But I want to at least show people that I'm still active. I'm there. So I'm there. I'm just a really late night streamer.
Yeah. Hove, it's like Triton's 5 a.m. stream, right?
Yeah, the one that you just made up so that you don't have to go see him stream. Oh, Triton, I can't watch you stream. You stream so early in the morning. 9 p.m. Eastern, by the way.
But that is cool, though, because like, I feel like it's nice to have people that you know that are streaming at a different time than is like the norm, you know? And so it's easy to jump in if, you know, so if you're listening to this and you're looking for a stream, you know, that you need to be aware of late at night, check out Nava because he's doing it. So I kind of want to jump into, I know we can jump into some community questions in a second here, but I wanted to see, Nava, if you could expand a little bit more your thoughts on the Destiny, the recent patch that had come out. I kind of just want to jump into that, because I know we all, me, Hove, and Triton got to talk about it pretty in depth, but I'm curious your thoughts on it. You were saying you were liking the primary game. I just wanted to hear your thoughts on the whole special ammo economy and everything.
Okay. Well, as far as, having primaries, I've been able to use a lot of different ones, and it's not just hand cannons. Actually, since it's come out, I've used less hand cannons than I previously had. I mean, because my vault, I think I have like 22 legendary hand cannons in there. Wow. That's not that including exotics. I'd love hand cannons the entire time I've had this game. But I've been working with a hero formula that I have with high stability and Firefly reactive reload.
Dang.
But I can play like mid on the map, and that thing shoots as fast as I can push the trigger down, and it's amazing. Like, I can, depending on if someone's weak, I can 3-4 tap, but I have 15 rounds, so it's 3 people down as long as I'm hitting headshots, and that stability is so high that it doesn't move. So I know I've made some people angry, because then they'll try and figure out a weapon to shoot me back, because I can see them, they're trying to use hand cannons, but I'm outside that range now, and I'm just picking them apart with headshots. And it's kind of funny. I'll see them switch to high auto, back to like a universal remote to like try and get in close. And I'm just like, no, I'm going to play my mid game. I'm going to just back up a little bit, or I'm going to go forward. And that's been a lot of fun to actually do now compared to the last meta, where I tried to do it a couple times, and it's just like, nope, people are going to shut you down, fly past you, and just hip fire, you know, a shotgun.
Yeah, it's good to hear somebody else running stability, because we had talked about it last week that it was kind of becoming a thing for people to run stability on it, and hearing you say that, it's like confirmation, like, yes, this is a thing, and it's pretty fun to play with.
Mm-hmm. And then, going for hand cannons too, I've worked with a Isolona that had high stability, Icarus, and rangefinder, because I was actually streaming, and a friend of mine, Clayton, he was playing with Ramblin', and they were testing that stability thing. I think the videos have come out now of them doing it, but that first week, they were like, hey, yeah, he was like, try stability out. And he was like, the rangefinder seems to not really determine too much anymore if you have rangefinder and rifle barrel. So I was like, sure enough, that first week of trial is like, I was just jumping left and right and just hitting people like on the fly and not worrying about like, oh, I need max range. It's like, no, I was just jumping left. It didn't matter if what class I had, that stability and that inner accuracy with the boost to it, and then Icarus, like, I was just hitting things, and it felt good.
All you need in life is Icarus. That's all you need.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
It's really good now. And then another thing, high fire auto rifles, at least for me, felt really good.
Yeah.
because I was just doing it for fun on one stream. I was like, well, let me try these out. They're probably not going to be that great. And I ended up having, I think, only one bad game, but everything else I was doing maybe a 1.5 to like almost a 4 KD every game.
Jeez.
Using high auto fire rate auto rifle.
Which one were you mainly using?
I think towards the end of the night I was using the exotic Kvostov.
Oh, okay.
But I started off with a Assembly 2 from New Monarchy that I kept on, which had counterbalance and another stability perk. So it was just blocking on people's heads. And it was the same thing. People were getting upset. Like, I saw him changing weapons. And it's like, oh, well, you know what? This is working for him, and he's killing me left and right. Let me try. And they're just trying to figure out something to do. And you really didn't need a sidearm. Like, I pulled out my sidearm maybe a couple of times to finish something off because I just killed two people. And I was like, well, I can't reload. And then I pulled up the sidearm. But they work really well in sixes. I haven't tried them out in threes. But like I said, I've had a lot of fun, and I've only had one or two bad games total since using those.
Yeah, the time that I really noticed that I was like, man, I might need to go try out a high fire rate auto rifle is when we were playing with Pope Bear the other night. And just the first few games, every time, like, he'd be on a 1v1 or a 1v2, and he'd be like, and they'd both be dead. And I was like, what is going on? Like, it was right when the patch changed, and no one really, like, the first night of trials, you know? And I was like, oh my gosh, like, I need to try that out. That was pretty awesome.
Well, I'm assuming that was a doctrine with Pope, right?
Yes, it was the dog, of course.
Is Pope ever not going to use the doctrine? Right, exactly.
it was funny. We actually, like, the first time the doctrine became a problem, that patch that boosted those things up, but we were doing it for fun on Anomaly, and we were just laughing so loud because Guardians just dying in, like, animation of them sprinting, and you saw them, like, fall forward on their face. And we were just, we were just hosing them down. It was me, Pope Bear, and a buddy, Corn Pops. And he's like, why are you guys laughing so much? You know, because he's playing with his hand cannon, and we're just going to town with these high rate fire rifles, just teaming people. And then and then eventually everyone found out and it became a problem, but we didn't know it was. We were just doing it for fun. We're like, let's see if these things work.
Yeah,
and sure enough, they did back then, and they're working again now.
Dude, I loved that season of weapon stuff. But what about special weapons? How have you been feeling about that coming from you know, well, I guess it feels a lot different in sixes, if that's the main thing that you're playing. But I know you also ran trials with us. How do you feel about not having special ammo in those different game times?
Well, after the couple of cards that we try to do, like, that I came in like cold, like I haven't touched the patch at all back then. I kept playing later, and then I actually didn't mind it too much. It slowed down a little bit, so you had time, because a lot of people were still trying to, like, hide inside the building, which is fine by me, because you can go sit in the building, because guess what, the capture point is outside.
Yeah.
So you can sit in there all you want, and I'm going to go build up my sniper ammo back up, and then sure enough, that's what I did. I didn't make Flawless. We got a whole bunch of 8-in-1 cards, but I had a lot more fun with it.
Yeah.
And there was less times because of less special that I felt, like, upset that I lost.
Uh-huh.
Because a lot of times I was just losing based on primary gun skill, at least a lot of the matches that I had.
Yeah.
With some of the people that I was playing with. It's like none of us were, like, really, like, totally upset. We're like, you know, that was actually a close game. Like, we weren't, like, screaming, and no one was, like, you know, swearing a storm. But, you know, it felt really good to me.
Yeah, that's cool. I feel like I felt that way at first, like, the first weekend. And even this weekend, too, whenever we were in it, I felt that way at first. I was like, yeah, you know, when I lose, you know, and I still feel that way. I still feel it's fair when I lose, you know, or it feels more, not that it's not, it's still my fault if I lose, but, like, it felt, you know, more fair. I wasn't, like, getting mad or anything when I lost the battles, but there was something about it that, like, weighed on me, and I think it was my own personal, like, what I think is fun kind of thing. And people were saying that initially, but I was like, no, I want to give it time. You know, I'm having fun with the primaries, you know. And finally, I guess it just started to weigh on me a little more this last weekend, where I was like, man, like, I feel like only having special ammo just that very first round, like, it just, like, wasn't enough for me, like, as far as I liked it. And then if I had to wait for the special, then I lost the inside, basically, or have to engage the people inside, or, you know, it kind of forces certain things, which is fine, you know, and it but it's like, I think I'm getting to a point where I can confirm that I like it the other way better, you know? Maybe not completely the way it was, but, like, having special at least more than the first round, whatever that means. Hove, I'm curious for you, have you been feeling the same way about it as you initially did, or?
I mean, I still think you know, we mentioned originally after Black Shield that we thought it was going to play much different on different maps other than Black Shield. Uh-huh. And I definitely think it did, but I'm also curious. I think the way that it's set up now, I think every map could play drastically differently. Like,
that's
even more,
true.
Every map plays differently anyway. But I mean, like, this past week, you know, my complaint, and it was just a personal complaint for Black Shield, is that unless people camped inside, it was like everything was so quick, at least when we played, I never got to snipe. And, you know, I love sniping.
Mm-hmm.
But this week it felt, you know, most rounds, if we wanted to, you know, as we made our way around the map, I could pick up at least one box and get a couple snipes off here and there. And I really enjoyed it this week. I thought the map played much better than I thought it would. You know, I know it has an inside that a lot of people camped in, but A, the point was in there, so you had to get in there. And B, there were, what, five doors into that room?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It made it a little bit easier if a team was going to sit inside to kind of make your way in. But I still think special ammo and trials need some kind of change. I really don't have any idea what. That's not, I don't know. I'm the gamer, not the, you know, the developer, but I don't know. You know, I still stick with what I said last week. Continuous game modes still feel good to me. I'm okay with them, but trials just needs something a little different, whether you lose half your ammo on death or all but a clip or just something. I just feel like it needs something.
Yeah. Yeah. And I guess we'll see even more how it feels once they, cause they already have this new patch coming out that's going to change the sidearm ammo along with some no land changes too, you know, with the flinch and everything. So I guess we'll have to wait and see how all that plays out. But I don't want it to make it sound like I was feeling like completely like I wasn't having fun. Cause I definitely had fun on the rounds that we played with Wilson, you know, and everything. And I don't know. Yeah, I'm still having fun. It just, I felt like I would have more fun if I had that special ammo that I was used to just more frequently. But I don't want to harp on it too long. It, like you said, it's still feeling good in, mm-hmm. in all the other game types. I just wanted to bring it up, do like a checkup, like, hey, where are we at with this kind of thing?
Yeah,
no, going back for this map, though, like Black Shield, I didn't find too much of a problem with anything too much. But this one definitely was hit and miss a lot of it. Like there was plenty of games where I had a good time, but then there's like some matches where I went where like I saw what people were tweeting about, like a lot of grenade spam,
mm-hmm.
And then people camping back and sitting, and it was kind of weird because I was playing with my friend Zerg SG from Kick from Orbit, you know, one of the other Destiny clans that does sweats and all that, and like I said, it's like fun, good games. And at some point, like I think we were playing off my host, and I think like 1 o'clock in the morning, like it just changed. It went from like good fun games to like just that grenade spam, people sitting in the back. We faced like a whole team of like three Stormcallers with icebreakers just holding off as far as they could. Like we had to push them. They would not do anything.
Wow.
And like I said, it just that kind of made it unenjoyable where it was like, you know what, we're just done. And I didn't go back after the first 2 days. And I think he played maybe the next day for like three cards and he's like, I'm done with trials this weekend too.
That helps me because I feel like I was kind of feeling that way. I think for different reasons, but that is interesting that he was feeling that way. And I don't feel like with this map in particular, what you were saying about like the grenade spam, like I felt that a lot this week. Like it was like, man, abilities feel so like special ammo taken out, like abilities feel like incredibly strong. Like it's so important to like start those engagements with a grenade because it like helps you out your primary gun battles so incredibly much.
Yeah.
Well, I kind of felt, you know, I mean, I definitely, you know, like we ran into a lot of Night Stalkers and Striker Titans with, you know, lightning nades and wombos, but it seemed to me like most of the grenade spam was fairly predictable though. It was right as they ran into a room.
Yes.
Right at that one door, you know, like we got, I know there were a couple games where, you know, we were stupid enough that three rounds in a row, we tried to like go through that door, got demolished. And then we were like, all right, let's change it up. Did something, maybe lost another round, because we came back from a few big deficits after
that,
we went,
yeah.
Okay, we're being stupid. Let's wait till those grenades are gone and then go a different way. And we kind of, you know, worked around it. Yeah, it can be annoying, don't get me wrong, but it seemed like very predictable, you know, ability spam. Like, it was kind of always in the same places.
Yeah, that was one of the most interesting things to me, what you said about coming back from a deficit. Like, there were a lot of 3-0, 4-0 games that we were playing, where we turned it back around. And I really thought that with the special ammo change, not starting with special, you would have less of a chance to make a big change like that. But it actually feels like it increases the chances of, hey, let's switch up our strategy, and whatever we change is more effective than if, you know, we all had special ammo for whatever reason. I don't know. It just seemed like there were a lot more crazy comebacks than previously.
Oh, yeah. I mean, my first card when I ran with Wilson and Marcus, I think it was the first card, Friday night, we ended up going flawless. We didn't lose a game. But three of our games, we went down 4-1.
And dang, back. three of them
and came back. And it, I think a lot of it too is the like I said, there's five ways in there and kind of the predictability of where teams were going to go. So, some teams, do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
hey,
yeah,
they all threw those grenades in that first middle door, so hey, we're going to go in this door, their grenades are gone, get that angle, team shot the first guy, you know. And that was our big thing once we started. You know, me, you, and Triton especially, we were letting a lot of people, we'd get a pick and then we'd fall off. Once we started, like, moving around as a team, getting that pick and then moving in, like you said, we came back from 3-0, 4-1, like, pretty easily once we started really figuring out what to do.
It's true. What I said about ability thing, too, I want to point out that shoulder charge saved my life so many times this weekend in that small little map. Like, I would just run a circle around one of those columns, and it one hit kills through a revive shield. Like, I was like, what is this, you know? And so that helped a ton. Nava, is there anything that you noticed that was, like, playing a lot different? Not necessarily playing a lot differently, but, like, seem more powerful than before because people didn't have special right away?
Not if anything's, like, I didn't see anything be more powerful than before. Like I said, shoulder charge is kind of back, not fully, like what it used to be. It's kind of there, because I love Striker Titans. I've run it since the very beginning of this game, since the alpha. But I was definitely able to use it a lot more because there wasn't, you know, that much special around. Same thing, like, in... Granted, you might want more special, but you're able to get more comebacks now because people can't lock down an area as well as they used to, because you get two people down or something like that around a door. Well, it's like, well, the enemy just has one guy sitting there with a shotgun, and you're like, you're never going to revive that person. And then the other two can, you know, get sides or get a different angle while the one's just sitting on both orbs or one orb.
Yeah.
So they can't do that as much anymore, which I find nice. And like I said, now you can actually push back, push around. You can flank around yourself, you can communicate with team, and yeah, you can turn it back. Because the same thing, we had a couple of games, not as many as you guys, but we had a couple of games where we were down 4-0 or 3-0, and then just kind of talking it out and picking one off at a time, and then turn it around on them.
That's cool.
But yeah, I didn't see anything come out, at least me personally, that I played against, like, too overpowered now with less special out.
I think, just quickly, this just made me think of something. You know, it's always been important to you know, get the first pick and try to lock down that body. You know, that's always important. But I feel like now it becomes even more important, because if you get that pick and go lock down the area where that body is, or even just keep them off of it, you're going to be the team who has an area locked down who gets the special. Even if they do, it's still 3v2 with special. You know what I mean? Like, if nobody starts out with special, now you have someone down, you have an area, and you lock down that special. You know, that becomes really important. If you fall behind and then you don't get special and you don't have an area, it can really, I don't want to say snowball, because, you know, it's still, obviously you can come back from it, but it just becomes really important.
Yeah. Another thing with that is, like, it's really important to get that revive, or to control that area as well, because if you let them get the jump on you and get that revive with overshields versus your primaries, like, that can be a really sucky battle.
Absolutely, yeah.
Well, you wanna move to some community questions, whether there's somebody in the chat or just if there's anything online, we can see what we got there.
I actually have a question that this was just completely random, but it's something that I was playing with Fusion Rifle a lot the last couple of days, which I normally do, but this one's for everybody. Completely silly, stupid question. But of the three elements on Fusion Rifles, which is your favorite to kill someone with? You know how they all have the different animation? Which one's the coolest looking to you?
Personally, I'm going to think about Void. I just kind of like how they slowly, like, lift up and just float away and disappear.
Yeah.
Void's definitely my favorite if I happen to use a fusion rifle. I don't do it too much, but every now and then I'll do it for fun.
I got to go Solar. I don't know. I really like Solar. Maybe it's because I didn't get a Solar fusion rifle that was worth using until, like, 2 weeks ago.
Did you never buy the Dead Orbit one, like, the last vendor iteration?
Because I had the Thiessen, or not the Thiessen, the Vacancy.
Yeah.
It was void, and I was like, I don't need
it. Yeah, yeah. The Hitchhiker, that's what it is, the Dead Orbit Hitchhiker. That one, it was so, because it was solar, and I've hit the furthest shots with a fusion rifle, like the furthest one hit kills ever with that thing. I know that it's technically like not as good as today's Saladin's Vigil, but there were just moments with that gun that I just connected the dots, and you know, all the planets lined up and I made a shot across the map, and I was like, oh my gosh, the range on this thing. And
you're right,
it wasn't,
you don't map people every week with any fusion rifle.
No, but I mean, it was like my jaw dropped afterwards. I was like, what was that? And I think it has to do with just, it's the Dark Blade Spite, you know, super high damage. It only needs 4 bolts to one hit kill someone, so if you land it just right, it rewards you for it. So that one was really fun. I think to answer the question though, mine would have to be Arc. I'm going to complete the diversity circle here and go with Arc, and I think it's just because I'm so used to my Arc one on my Thiessen. But I did really like the Vacancy, the Void one, the way what Nava was saying, how it just slowly
float.
Picks
yeah.
up their body. And one of the first slow motion like video things that I did was a thing on Burning Shrine where I had vooped someone with the Vacancy, and they literally did a backflip in the air in slow motion and disintegrated, and I was like, that was so beautiful. Like, there's nothing better looking than that.
Yeah, you can just kind of stop and just look at it and not care about what else is going around. You're just watching that one body just go away.
Yeah, if I die, no big deal.
Lego has gotten to the point, yeah. he's pointed out multiple times while we've been running trials, that he'll specifically fusion someone knowing they're already dead just to still see their body evaporate.
Oh,
because
yeah.
even if they die, you can still like fusion their body, and he'll be like, oh yeah, I got him. He was like, I knew he was dead, but I don't care. I wanted to see him float away.
Yeah, if you didn't know, whenever somebody's dead and their body is laying there on the ground, the ragdoll, you know, that flies away, whether it's instantly after or if it's just on the ground, you can shoot a fusion rifle at it and it will disintegrate the color of your fusion rifle that you shoot, which is so much, it's so satisfying. Even if they're already dead and they, or somebody takes your kill and they shotgun them and their body's flying and then your bullets hit them and then they evaporate the other direction, it's so satisfying. I love it so much.
It makes Lego very happy, trust me.
It seems like
oh, I got it.
So Chibi Kim asks, what got you into playing Destiny, and are you looking forward to Mass Effect Andromeda?
So what got me into it, actually, when I originally saw like the first E3 stuff and all that, I thought it was gonna be more MMO type of game, and I was like, it seems really interesting, like it could be cool, like an MMO on a console. And when I started reading the stuff or at least looking at things, I'm like, ooh, I can be like the Bubble Titan. It seems to be like it might be a support class. So in my head, when I got the game or when it was going to come out, before I learned more information about it, I was like, that's what I want to run. I want to run a tank/support type class. I don't want to be the mass dealer. I mean, granted, that's fun. Everyone wants to, you know, be the DPS guy, but sometimes it's nice just to be that like tank, that focal point, that anchor for a whole team. So originally, that's what I thought the game was going to go towards, like what it was going to be. You know, and then it became the shooter, the shared, what do they call it? Shared world shooter,
yeah.
That it is now.
Shooter looter.
And yeah, and then it's definitely been a lot of fun, but that's what I originally thought the game was going to go. So that's how it caught my attention. I was like, ooh, you can pick up stuff. You can pick up weapons. There's going to be different types. They're going to have elements. So that caught my attention.
What you're saying is that your ideology of what you want to be in Destiny really lines up with the other Bear's, Pope Bear's version of what he wants to be in Destiny. He's always talking about like, oh, I want to be the support class, and that's why he's always running, well, he was always running Defender Titan. I guess he can't for a little while here, but he will be again soon, I guess.
Yeah, like it just seems fun, and I don't know. Enjoyed that role too with like World of Warcraft. I used to play that, and I was a mage. It was never like a heavy dealer, but I did enough, but I also could push things away. Like it was just keeping like aggro away from me, but enough damage going out. Like I said, it was supporting in a way where I wasn't like, I guess, the hero in that situation. That's the same kind of role I play here in the Destiny community. Like I said, you're not going to see me all the way out there and trying to be like top on the list. Like I'll be there, but more or less I enjoy the aspect of helping people.
Yeah.
Well, keep in mind, even if you know you don't look at yourself as someone on the top of the list and out in front and everything, just keep in mind to let Pope know next time you play with him that Lego, just according to him, Pope Bear is the other bear. You are not a bear. Pope Bear is the other bear. Just keep that in mind.
Oh, that's what I tell Pope too. He's like the other bear.
In Destiny 2, do you hope to see more of that kind of role? Are you hoping for more subclass alterations where you can be more of that support class that you were originally looking for?
It wouldn't have to be like necessarily a whole class. They could probably add different perk trees or just redo the whole skills of what the existing classes and have something like that where something can be a little bit more supportive in nature. But I kind of like how it is now with the setup that they have going. Granted, if they give us more, you know, that's more than welcome. But like I said, you can still just have the same three classes, but then just redo the skill trees and how things operate from there.
Cool.
But more or less, I hope it goes a little bit more open world than we have now.
Yeah.
Like, that would be enough for me just to put me back into PvE.
Nice. Yeah. No, I think that's what we all hope for, especially when we first got Destiny. We're like looking for that true open world stuff. So here's hoping for D2.
And yes, Kim, I am looking forward to Mass Effect Andromeda. I just finally pre-ordered the deluxe edition last night on Origin. So I'll be on PC. Nice. Can't help it. I got a nice PC and I want to see those graphics as best I can. So I'll take that over my PS4.
Sorry. Well, here, let's add on the question from last week then, since he's big into PC. If Destiny comes to PC, Destiny 2, what console/PC will you main?
As far as main, I'll probably still do PS4 because that's where all you guys are at and everything like that. But if I want to make, and I was talking to Mesa Sean about this as well, I see more content creators, if they're gonna get footage, they're gonna do it on PC because if they're able to adjust resolution, mm-hmm. the scales, they're gonna want the best footage they can put up there. And you can do that with a PC rather than a PS4.
Yeah.
So if it enables that for them to do it, I see a lot of them will be capturing footage for videos, background footage, on the PC rather than a PS4. They'll still put up like their raids and stuff like that because they'll do it where their fans are at. You know, they're obviously not going to cut them out, but if people are going to capture solo stuff for videos, it's probably going to be on PC. And if I start making videos for Destiny again, they'll come from PC if it is going to PC.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I wonder if we'll see a split at all in the people who are creating content, like YouTube content, versus those who are streaming it on Twitch. Because if you're wanting to play with the community in the moment, you probably would want to be on a console. I'm guesstimating here that there's going to be a large population of Destiny players on console. But then maybe, like, you know, like you said, creating content, maybe we'll see more YouTubers maining that PC account. I don't know. That's interesting.
Mm-hmm, yeah, because even if it does, I don't think the PC community is going to be that large, whoever joins. Mm. So everyone's big viewership is still going to be PS4 based.
Yeah,
I wholeheartedly believe that. Even if PC comes in, like I said, there might be people who will switch over and go and do it, but for everyone, it'll probably be PS4 they'll stick to.
Yeah, Resolute's here. Who wouldn't want to be here?
Exactly.
All right. Buddha asks, cereal before milk or milk before cereal?
Cereal before milk, and Lumi is a monster for having milk before Sarah. And I've told him that in person in party chats. I'm like, you're a monster.
Poor Lumi. Yeah.
I have an exception to this rule, actually, because I've been thinking about it. It's asked on a lot of other podcasts, you know, and I was like, you know, cereal before milk, you know, seems like always the way to go. Like, it's a sin not to. But then I was thinking, and I was like, wait, there is one exception for me. And that is, this is going to sound so ridiculous. I would put Raisin Bran cereal in, and put the milk in, but then sometimes I would like add more like cereal to it a little, because I don't want it to get soggy, because if you like put it all in at once, it gets super soggy, and it's the one thing that like I just want a little bit of it, so I'll just put a little bit of cereal in the milk afterwards and then put some sugar on it.
That's more like just adjusting the ratios as opposed to
okay? Yeah, okay, yeah, I wasn't sure if I was breaking the rules.
Same thing, like the other day I had a nice bowl of Fruity Pebbles. You know, and I finished the actual Fruity Pebbles, and there was a little bit of milk, and I was like, well, that milk already has some flavor to it. You know, they've been soaking it, so let me add a little bit more cereal and then some more milk.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
Okay.
That way's fine.
Okay, I'm good.
Whew. All right. Jimmy Pike, HK, asks, if you could make any change to the special ammo economy as it is, what would it be?
The only change I personally see, and I've talked to other people too about it, is with sidearms, and that would just be either they have the one magazine in the gun itself, not reserve, nothing like that. Yeah. Or they can keep what they have, but you would drop down the damage on sidearms really low.
Mm.
because like in my head when I hear sidearms, I hear support, I hear help. So if I'm running out, like I said, when I was using the high fire rate of auto rifles, I would only switch to it when I was almost out of ammo. When I had like I looked at my magazine, I had like 3 rounds. I'm like, well, I know I'm not going to kill anyone with 3 rounds. Let me switch over to the sidearm, you know, and then do damage, and then just reload both of the guns and then get back into the action.
Yeah.
So I would see that personally as a change, because I really do want primaries to always be the focus. So right now, if nothing else changed besides just the sidearms, like if we kept everything else how it is, I would either just reduce the sidearm to the one magazine completely, or reduce their damage to very minimal as a support. Like when you just have to, you can't reload. It's like, okay, let me pull out the sidearm, because it's always ready. I mean, that's kind of like the point of it. So it should be there to kill one person, and you shouldn't be able to kill three with your magazine.
Yeah,
with a sidearm. Because I've had what Future War Cult,
the sidearm. Wormwood. Yeah,
there we go, the Wormwood. Because I've seen that like beat out Last Words.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like multiple times. I'm like, it shouldn't happen as a sidearm versus a primary weapon, right. Even with it's if it was realistic, like bullet diameters and stuff like that. It's like, it's a small 22 versus like say 50 cal, but then the small 22 is going to beat the 50 cal. Like that shouldn't work that way.
Yeah.
Like it's a smaller weapon, smaller caliber, you know, versus a larger weapon with a larger caliber. Like it should be their support, not for your main weapon. So that was the only change I would do, is just work on the sidearms. But like I said, I've had plenty of fun with this meta right now currently.
That's cool. I'm 100% with you actually on if I could change anything about special, that would be the main thing, is the sidearm thing. And the one, I like how you said one clip, because on I was listening to last week's episode, I think I said like, you know, whatever they start with is what I want, but I feel like that's too much. Like I feel like one clip every time is like the way to go, and that keeps it in that sidearm category rather than the prime arm category, you know.
Prime
and
arm.
So yeah, prime arm, you don't want any prime arms running around. And then other than that, I would, one little thing on top of that is I really like the idea that we were talking about last week of trials being different for different rounds, and like maybe even incorporating special ammo into certain rounds rather than just the first round, and then have some rounds without, like just more variety. I just really like that idea in trials in particular, just because it opens up the door for just a ton of variety.
Well, yeah. So basically we all cut, because I'm kind of with you. Pretty much we're saying that once they go through with what they said they were going to go through, we're going to be happy, right?
I hope
changing,
so.
Changing, cutting down the sidearm ammo, we'll all be pretty satisfied.
Yeah, I'll be fine. Like I said, I've changed weapons too. That's the biggest thing too, because like I said, I love hand cannons. I have a whole bunch in my vault, even though I've deleted a whole bunch, I still managed to keep, you know, 20 plus of them. But I've taken those different weapons, I've tried them out, and they do work. And that's another thing. It's like you yourself have to be able to try something new besides falling back. And it's like, oh, you know, I love hand cannons, I'm staying too. And I was like, you know what? I love them. I know I'm good with them, but let me go try a different weapon. Let me try this one and see if it works well in trials. It works well in threes. And there's some that I found that I really enjoy. And then I just got to teach myself how to use it properly. Like I said, with that Heroes Formula, like I know it's a mid-range. I can do all right close range, but I know I want to play strictly mid-range, and I want to keep myself balanced between where the enemy's spawning in certain points. And that's why I know that gun works really great. Like I said, it frustrates people who are using hand cannons when that damage drop-off just isn't there. And I know I'm hitting them for, you know, twice of what they're hitting me.
Yes.
So it's something I'll stay. I'm like, okay, you can hit me, I'll stand right here, but I know I'm pelting you in the head 4 times and you're done.
That's exactly how I felt with Jade Rabbit last weekend too, on a big open map like Black Shield. Every time somebody, and I wish I would have figured it out whenever I was playing with you and Pope Nava at first, because yeah. Once I figured that out, I was like, oh my gosh, everything's changing. I can hit everything.
All right, we got one more, but I wanted to make a point. I don't know why I didn't think of this last week, Lego, when you mentioned, you know, more diversity, whether it was changing rounds and stuff like that.
Yeah.
That makes me think, whatever happened to them trying different things in trials? Remember they did the spooky trials 2 weeks, and then they did the first light trials, and they were like, we're going to keep doing stuff like this to keep you on your toes and keep it fresh. And I don't think they've done anything, right?
Did they actually say that, though?
I thought Mantis said, like, they were experimenting with things.
I think maybe that's what they said, but it wasn't like a promise, like, hey, you'll see this again soon or anything
right.
like that.
I just, I mean, not necessarily that stuff, but I just thought that they said something like, hey, we're looking at doing different things.
Mm-hmm.
And then they haven't. I mean, not a complaint. I'm just, I don't know. I just kind of forgot about it.
I would love it if stuff like that came back, if they just switched it up another weekend. I even loved it. Like, I might get hate mail for this, but I loved playing on First Light. Like, I thought it was fun to just throw something in there completely different, you know, just to have everybody use different guns than they were normally using. Everyone was running a scout rifle or, you know, whatever. I thought it was a ton of fun.
Yeah, so I enjoyed First Light, too. I just... because I can actually snipe again. That was why I was so excited. Yes. And I was like, I don't worry about it being super close to me. Like, I can sit here and I can snipe and I can go around and, like, just scout the map and find people and just pick them off from far away. Mm-hmm. So that was definitely First Light. It was a lot of fun for me, as well as Spooky Tries. I know a lot of people hated it because they didn't have any radar. Uh-huh. And revives were not revives, but death was, like, permanent per round. But that was probably the easiest of time I've had going flawless compared to, like, what was it, the first year that Trials came out, when I actually used to do carries way back when.
Yeah. I do hope, I hope they bring it back, and maybe an iteration, because the thing everybody had a problem with was having no radar. Like, a lot of people were upset with that. Like, maybe just bring it back where there's no revives at all. Like, something like that. I don't know. I would love to see something different like that. I'm glad to hear you enjoyed it too, Nava, because I'm always curious, like, what do people think about it?
Yeah, well, it goes back to the whole thing where, like I was saying, like, communication. Like, I didn't need a radar if people are telling me what they're seeing, what they're doing.
Yeah.
Even if it's, like, not even they engage someone, but, like, hey, I just saw someone go into, I believe it's called, like, the bone room. Like, they just saw, like, an enemy go in there. It's like, well, now we know where one's at.
Yes.
So we know one's on the map over here on this side. And then just stuff like that. It's like, then you can put your mental picture together. And that's why I enjoyed it, and I had a really fun time. My team, like we said, it was really easy for us. We just talked and just went through and just destroyed teams. It was a lot of fun.
I have to be honest, that is the moment that I learned what room one and room two were on that map.
Oh, which one? Anomaly?
Yeah.
Oh, for Anomaly. Oh,
I was like, what do you mean? Why did you number them? They were like, I think it was Wendell. He was like, they're real big on the wall. And I was like, oh.
It's like big yellow paint right there.
Yeah. I didn't name them. It has a one and a two on it.
Yeah. 2 points that were brought up in chat that I just wanted to point out. One that it's been asked for so long, and they've never even hinted at it, that I think the demand for it has died off, but flipping spawns every round. I mean, they have asked for that. I mean, not everybody, but it was a big thing. It seems like a simple idea, and they've never even seemed to entertain it, so it kind of fell off. But the other thing, and I like this, they've done it a few times, and even if they limited it to, like, maybe three maps a weekend, but having the rotating maps I thought was a lot of fun. You know, maybe not every map in the rotation, but do you remember, like, the week they just did, what was it, Earth maps, and there were
Earth
five
maps,
of them?
Earth maps, yeah.
Yeah.
Even if it's just three random maps, at least it gives you something a little different, you know, kind of, because everyone loves Burning Shrine as far as the map, but everyone is freaking tired of it because it's been, you know, the Trials map so many times.
I would definitely go with either flipping spawns or adjusting spawns on all map, like, actually having equal spots as best they could. I mean, there's some where it's like, why are you spawning me outside and spawning a team inside when you're giving clear advantage?
Yes. Firebase is one that one sticks out, like, to me like that.
Yeah, so I'd rather that be adjusted first, and then from there do the flipping the spawn and then doing the rotation. I'd rather just have even spawn in total and then rotate the spawn and then rotate the maps.
Yeah, I love the map rotating thing. I do hope they bring that back. And I think it's a hit every time they do it. I don't think people are ever that upset with it.
I still think, like I said, I would still like it to be limited to a certain number of maps because, and I do have, you know, set players that I play with most of the time, but I feel like rotating maps definitely favors people that play together more often.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
You know, because you may already have your strategy down for any map. Whereas if somebody picks someone up from LFG, okay, maybe by the end of the first game, they have their strategy on Firebase, and they still lose 5-4. And then it goes to Pantheon, and they're a shit show again because they've never played together. You know, it definitely favors teams that play together. But
One thing I was thinking about with the spawn rotation thing, or flipping spawns in a single game, it could be one of those things. There's a lot of different things in Destiny that are just like, you know, in the spaghetti code somewhere, there's stuff. It's not a simple flip of a switch because no other game type does that. And so, like, just take No Land Beyond, for example. Like, No Land Beyond is a primary sniper that they've never been able up to this point to adjust to where the flinch that you see is actually applied to the gun. And even in the This Week at Bungie this last week, whenever they said, hey, we're going to adjust this, they said, oh, we found a way to like trick it, you know, to make that work. Like, they're not actually fixing the underlying problem. They're like adding something. We hacked it, basically, our own game, to make it work, you know. That wasn't the exact wording, but that's what it sounded like,
right?
You know, and so I just know the code. Yeah. That's one of those things that makes me really look forward to Destiny 2. Like, maybe the code, maybe they've got new code that's going to be cleaner, that they can make those changes, you know, like rotating spawns and stuff that we think should be an easy fix, but maybe the spaghetti code of Destiny 1, it's a little more difficult than we think to do.
Spaghetti code, are you Lego or Tefty?
Is that his thing? Okay, I knew I stole it from somebody, probably.
You know, it's definitely, I'd love to see that as a better code for them, so they can do something, like going back to Battlefield. Sorry, love Battlefield, and the way they can do changes.
Preach it.
Is that they're, it seems like the way that Battlefield is able to change their guns so easily is because they're all coded individually. Because we see here with Destiny, it's like, well, we're going to change like the range on hand cannons, but it changes the entire class of hand cannons.
Yeah.
Like, they don't seem to be able to just be like, well, hey, palindrome's a little bit outside the range, let's bring that in. It's just like, well, if we adjust this one, it's going to bring everything else down. You know, so it's like, we can't do that. So they got to figure out a different way to hopefully get them to do individual stats. Because right now it seems they can't do individual stats per weapon, and they can only change, the abilities of it. Because like, they took away the last word perk pretty much on last word. Like, that's, you know, pretty much gone. But that was the only way they can change it. They were like, oh, we can adjust, you know, the range on it, you know, individually, or we can't adjust this. It was just like, you know what, the best way to fix this is just to remove the perk or turn down the perk.
Yeah.
Like, so I hope their next game and their next engine, their next build has that ability for them to just be like, hey, this is the one outlier, let's fix that one, rather than like, let's try and see how this whole class can get adjusted without breaking it. So I'm hoping that's what they're able to do in the coming years.
I think it'll definitely be closer to that, you know, than it was now, because, you know, we know that they were having trouble fitting things in. But, you know, because even with stuff like vault space and everything, you know, they admitted that the old generation was holding them back. And obviously when they try to code stuff, they're going to try to do it all together. So, as, you know, Lego said, spaghetti code. Everything is, you know, woven together. Hey, let's change Hungering Blade. Whoops, we messed up every health perk.
Yes, there's the example I was looking for.
Right. So, no, I think you're right, Nava. I think, you know, hopefully, but optimistically, I think it'll be different for the next game. So last community question we have here was from it was back a little bit, but it was a good one. It's from Buddha again, and we'll make this a quick one, just a rapid fire one. What is your favorite hand cannon of all time? And I guess this is specific role, like your hand cannon.
Oh,
my favorite has always been the last word. The animations, the sound on it, the handling has always just been my favorite, especially when I used to do, back when I used to do carries, it was Blade Dancer, Last Word, and then Sniper.
Oh, yeah.
And I use that constantly all the time. But still, even to this day, even though it might get out, you know, beat by other weapons, I still like to put that weapon on and just try and use it. So Last Word's definitely my favorite.
Yeah, that's cool. It's so unique, and it's survived through so many different metas too. It's always been viable in some way, even if it's not at the tip top, you know. I don't know, it, like, even now, just tapping that thing like we were talking about last week, and it feels so good just to just not hold down the trigger and be able to get those range, like knowing that you can just hit it once and it's going to get that range really far away, is so nice right now. So this is like a really difficult question for me, because I'm like, am I talking about like usability, or am I talking about just like the
your
looks of it?
Favorite.
I can't choose just one. It's
you
so difficult.
To. You get to take one into Destiny 2. That's it. All your other hand cannons
are
gone.
Oh my gosh.
Forever. You can't even go back to Destiny 1 to look at them.
Then I will take Lord Highfixer then, because it was my very first legendary. I went back and looked at the clip I had today of like the very, I had it at the end of some video, and it was me opening, I don't know if it was a Cryptarch package or an Ingram or something, but I opened it up and it just happened to be a legendary Lord Highfixer. And I remember watching one of my first streams on Twitch, that was somebody going through Vault of Glass, and they had a legendary Lord Highfixer. I was like, that gun, I need that hand cannon. It does so much damage. And then I got one to draw. It was my very first legendary hand cannon. And so I fell in love from then. I'm not like as in love in this current state of my game, certain state of the game. I have one with Icarus, and you know, it has Outlaw, I think, and Icarus, and I don't know, it's great, but I still like just usability. I'm still always using my AS Luna, but I love the Lord Highfixer. It's great.
My favorite, it's an easy one. It's not, again, same thing. It's not the best one. I still have it, but my Finale's Peril. I loved that gun for so long. I had, I want to say like Grenadier, something like kind of useful, but not great, but it also had Rifled and Outlaw, right when you first needed Rifled. And it was just, you know, now I have a Luna with Icarus and Rifled, and I finally got my Palindrome with Icarus, Hidden Hand, and Rifled. So I don't really use the Finales, but literally just today, right before the podcast, I was playing with Rally, and I was pulling out some other guns, and I thought about it, and I was like, if I could still get a Finales with Icarus, obviously I can't, I was like, I would use that over all of them. I just loved that gun. It just felt so good to me, and I don't know why.
I bet the one now that you have is still pretty usable in the current meta now. So
I just got so used to Icarus, I can't, like, I jump around like an idiot.
I do have to add a second. Like, there's another gun that isn't Last Word, but it's still something else I'd love to fall back on. Yeah. It's never been, like, a great weapon to use, but for some reason I enjoy using it, but is the Revelator. I don't think you can get any more.
Oh, yeah.
I think you can.
Yeah. Oh, you can.
Oh, in the old playlist, the original. What is it called?
Everything drops across everything now. Remember, they changed. Like, you can get a Luna in regular. I think you can get it anywhere. I'm pretty sure.
Okay, but yeah, there's a Revelator I've kept on for forever, and I love using the damn thing.
I know I saw one drop recently. I know that you can still get them from somewhere. That's all.
But I had Outlaw, Luck in the Chamber, and Brace Frame, and it only has 6 shots in it, but it shoots so quick, it's almost on the level of Last Word right now, as long as you're pulling the trigger.
Yeah.
So you can actually kill, reload, almost as quick as you can with the Last Word. But you have to be more precise in it, because it definitely needs to be headshot damage with that weapon.
That's
but
cool.
It's a lot of fun.
Well, since Nava threw out a second one, I'm going to throw out a second one. No, because the Amelon Ufern that I have, that is Luck in the Chamber, Outlaw, and it has Rifle Barrel too, I think, on it. And the stability is already really great on it. And it just, I don't know, the gun, the sound it makes, and the way it flips out so quick. It's like a little, it's like it should be a sidearm, the way it looks and everything, but it's a hand cannon. It operates terribly. I don't actually like using it right now, but I loved it in the last meta before range mattered anyway.
Well, I don't have a second one, but I also just want to point out that one of the reasons I loved using my Finales was because Lucas would always give me shit about it. He'd tell me how he would go, God, you and that stupid, terrible hand cannon, why are you using that? Like, I'd go on like a 10 kill streak, and he'd be like, God, that hand cannon's so stupid. It's so ugly.
Why does he hate hand cannon so? Because he just hated the Palindrome, right?
I don't know. Well, he hates that because it looks ugly. Well, he hated the Finales because it looked ugly.
That's what I mean. Yeah. He just hates guns.
He only used the Last Word for like 6 months because he wanted to be a space cowboy. Seriously, he said that. That's a true story.
Oh, Lucas.
Well, that's all I got for questions.
Yeah. Let's hit last thing here. Let's go over the This Week at Bungie. They didn't release too much stuff, but they did give us like a heads up about tomorrow at 9 a.m. Pacific time. Is that the time? Correct time? Yeah. I think so. 9 a.m. Pacific.
I don't know why they didn't just push back the TWAB. They've done it before.
See, that's what I wanted to ask you guys about. What do y'all think? What would be so significant or insignificant that they would announce it tomorrow morning instead of tonight? Like, what would change that? Like, what would make them do that?
Right off the top of my head, the only thing I can see them do that now is because isn't PAX East, like, up really soon?
Uh-huh. Yeah, because...
So maybe they want to make sure that's out before PAX East, because... Right now, I'm just speculating because there could be something they want to put out either in like for the game to show a little bit, and then PAX East they might put out something else or some announcement, not huge, but something enough like, hey, this is what's going to come. This was actually coming, so you get a small taste before PAX East, and then
But why not just do it in the TWAB today?
No idea.
I know. Do you have any ideas, Hove?
No, because it doesn't sound like it says it's an article, and it's going to be on the blog. So it's not like they're preparing some stream or something, as far as I can tell.
Okay, so, yeah. I've got two. I like the PAX East thing because I think that that does play a role. But PAX East doesn't really start till March 10th, which is a few days away still. But the two things that immediately came to my mind were either one, since it's like you said, it's just a page, like maybe artwork or video or pictures or for whatever they're going to show off, like the dawning. So the dawning, they had a full like page, you know, that you could scroll down that had like different pictures and stuff. And they had a promo video for it too and stuff. So maybe that artwork just isn't done yet. And they're like, we want to tweak some stuff and tweak the text, what it says. And maybe they're like, okay, we'll do it tomorrow morning. We're not ready tonight. That could be one reason. And then the other reason, they're both not ready reasons. I guess I have a third. Second reason, also not ready, is maybe this is completely hypothetical. Maybe there's like a patch that is going to come out at the exact same time as whatever they're announcing, and it is going to go live in the morning, you know, because they typically do morning stuff. But even then, it's weird. Like, a Friday is just a weird thing to push something off to. And then the third thing is maybe it's a super big announcement, and so they want, like, tweets and announcements just go better in the morning than they do at night, typically.
Exactly, yeah, hit that. Because it's Pacific time, so, yeah, 9 o'clock Pacific, you know, a lot of things are announced then because everyone's up and awake and they're at work or they're doing whatever. They just know they're going to hit the biggest audience at that time.
I think my vote is that there was some, whether it be artwork or some file or there's something, and the person who has it and needed to get it to Deej was sick today, and he'll be in tomorrow at 9 a.m.
I thought of that. I thought maybe it was just somebody sick.
Yeah. Well, cause wouldn't that be Cosmo? Does he have a broken toe?
Yeah, it's Cosmo's broken toe.
Yeah. You say he wasn't able to walk into the studio today. He's like, sorry, guys.
Oh, my gosh.
Give it to him tomorrow.
But no, I mean, that's not a bad thing, that because, you know, 9 a.m. Pacific is people are already starting to get to work or at work in the West Coast, and that's midday here on the East Coast, so kind of like you said, everybody across the country is kind of up and in the middle of their day. But I don't see them announcing something that big that they would need to do. I hope it is, but it just seems, I don't know. I'm
gonna go out on a limb and I'm gonna be positive and be like, it's going to be a bigger announcement than we think it's going to be. Like, and even I say that saying, like, even them bringing back the old raids could be that, you know, because that, even though that's kind of what we're all expecting, it could bring back old players if they're like, hey, they're bringing back the Vex Mythic class, they're bringing back all these old exotics, all the old raid legendaries, everything's being brought back up, and that people will be like, what, you know, I can go play everything again, you know, for the first time, kind of, in a way.
Yeah.
Well, I thought they said something here, because I know a couple people mentioned that on Twitter, but it says something about new stuff. I guess fresh challenges could be. I don't know. Because it says tomorrow we'll begin the conversation about what's next, including fresh challenges for you to tackle and the sandbox changes that were previewed last week.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess we'll just have to wait and see. It's by the time people are listening to this podcast on iTunes or YouTube, you will know what the answer is, and you will know which one of us has won the bet of what is coming.
It also sounds like it's still news of news, as you like to put it, Lego, because it says you should expect an announcement and a reveal schedule, not like a release schedule. Hey, we're going to tell you today that we'll tell you tomorrow about when we're going to tell you what's coming out in 2 months.
Yeah, but I'd rather have that than nothing.
Oh, no, I'm not complaining. It's just really funny the way they, like, we'll tell you tomorrow, today, about the next day, about what's coming in the future.
Well, they're starting the reveal schedule now. They're revealing to you tomorrow.
They're revealing the reveal schedule. It's perfect.
Oh, my gosh. I am excited, though, to have something, because at minimum, what we're going to get tomorrow is, hey, this is kind of what the live team is bringing. And, you know, for the next content thing, that's probably going to be PvE oriented. And then also, here's when we're changing Scory's No Land and Sidearms. You know, this is when that patch is dropping. So it'll be something for both worlds. We'll at least find out when those things are happening at a minimum tomorrow. That's what we can expect, I think.
Yeah. Do you think we'll see a light level increase? I know it sounds ridiculous, but April Update had one, and that was just the live team.
Yeah.
If they're trying to keep people fresh till June when they start, you know, a presumably announcing stuff. Even if there's no new content, just like, hey, here's 10 more light. And
yeah, I guess it could.
A reskin of 2 years ago's Trials weapons.
Yeah.
Maybe I can get my Finalis Peril again.
Oh my gosh. What if they bring back every weapon, every gear set ever for the very last, you know, patch that Destiny brings?
I'd
like
quit.
Just content overload.
I wouldn't quit.
It'd be nice, but I'd like to see a complete wipe in Destiny 2.
Oh yeah, me too. Sorry, did I say Destiny 2? I just meant
No, I'm just going like everything. They bring everything up to light level and bring all the weapons back, but I would just rather have a complete wipe after that fact. Like Destiny 2 starts with everything gone, kind of like how you start Mass Effect 2, like it's brand new. It's like you had everything before, you blow up a Shepard and Mass Effect 2, they bring it back and you have nothing. It's like you just restart. And that's open, so.
You just reminded me of one other thing. So another potential thing for tomorrow, not what caused it or anything, but another potential thing, just the way the wording was phrased and everything made it seem like, and Watts was one of the ones who was talking about this on Twitter, like maybe we might see some sort of content, like whatever the next or last content update that we get is, whatever the live team brings us, maybe it's something that could lead us into Destiny 2. Like, because one of the things that Deej says in the article is like, we'll see how you guys feel about it or something like that. And it was like, man, like maybe I don't know, it just made it seem like maybe there's something bigger story-wise that could happen that is kind of divisive to get us to move the story forward into Destiny 2. And that's totally hypothetical, but I know I'm not the only one thinking it after reading the This Week at Bungie. So I've got, you know, a little bit of hope that something like that would happen. What would you all think about that? A sort of live event happening, or maybe a story change in Destiny that kind of leads into Destiny 2?
I'd be down with that. I mean, even something as simple as like in the past when they've done like, you know, the wolves start prowling on patrol or something like that.
Uh-huh.
I mean, just something really small, but at least it's something to, you know, how this community is. You put one little thing, like you put a Cabal ship in the sky that you can barely see, and people speculate about that till Destiny 2. You know what I mean? And I mean that in a good way, like that.
Yeah.
We've said before, if they just showed a title screen and said, "Hey guys, we're making Destiny 2." Like we didn't already know, people would, that'd be hype for a month.
Yeah, no, as long as it's something small, like you said, like the wolves are prowling, something like that. Like if that gets put in the game, that's plenty enough for me. Like I don't need something huge. I'd rather not have any like spoilers or any main like juicy like morsels given to me of information. Like it's just enough. It's like, okay, this is what we're kind of looking forward to. And it's the same way I do with like games I'm very excited about. Like I will not try to watch streams or I scroll past something on Twitter. I'm like, oh, I'm not going to see that right now. I'm like, I'll wait. Like I try and keep myself as blind as possible in those situations. But I would like a little bit to know what is coming if they're going to do something that way, whether it just be another message on the forums or something like that. Like, hey, this is what we have planned, because you're right. At the end, he does say it should be an interesting moment for the community. So obviously it's going to reach out. So if it's something like that, I think the community, for the most part, will enjoy it. Of course, there's always people who will be like, well, it's not enough for me. Like, I need to know this right now. And it's like, I'd rather just have a little bit than everything, because then once it happens and you already know everything, it's like, well, that wasn't as fun as it could have been.
Yeah, I understand.
Do you think they'll just say tomorrow that they're going to reveal something at PAX East? Even if it's just a spring update, do you think they'll have some kind? If they're going there, do they have a booth or are they just like chilling?
That's a possibility, but like why would they put that off till tomorrow to say that, hey, we're going to have something later?
I don't know. It doesn't say anything about a booth. It just says, you know, D's trying to drag Cosmo around with his broken toe.
Right. I was just saying, I don't remember if it was PAX or if I'm thinking further back, but I remember them saying that they didn't have, there was something they were going to where they didn't have an official presence, but they were just going to like be there.
I got one last story driven PVE Lego far out there theory to throw at you. I got to throw out at least like 5 an episode. So here's my last thing that I was thinking about today as I was reading all the Twitter stuff and everything. What if because I was talking about like an event that like threw us into Destiny 2. The thing that I was thinking of was a little bit larger scale than just like a wolves are prowling thing. But what if it was like you know, everybody keeps saying a potential thing to happen is the tower being destroyed and we have to start all over, you know, that kind of idea. Well, what if what destroys us isn't something from the outside, but something from the inside, and like the factions themselves, like Dead Orbit, New Monarchy, and Future War Cult, end up tearing each other apart and become the doom of the city, basically, in some fashion. And we end up having, I guess we have enough enemies, so that probably wouldn't work. But I just think that, like, you know, the faction thing hasn't really been utilized in Destiny that much, and I wonder if that could be a bigger thing in Destiny 2. I don't know.
Possibly.
Okay, I'm done with my wild theories for tonight.
I just want to point out, JLH just said it was PAX. They said they're going for community reasons, not for an info release.
Okay, good. Thanks for the heads up, man. Well, I think we're gonna close down the talk for tonight. We've talked about a few things here, gotten to know our man NavaBear here. Thank you so much for coming out tonight, yeah, man. It's
a pleasure being here.
Sure, man.
This has been Lego, aka Legole Flash. You can find me on Twitter, Twitch, YouTube, making ridiculous videos and talking to you guys about Destiny stuff. Hove, where can they find you?
Twitch, Twitter, YouTube at Hove76. That's HOV76. And Triton, who couldn't be here tonight, he was a little busy with some in real life stuff. Make sure you check him out too. Also, Twitter, Twitch, YouTube at Triton, please. The please being PLZ.
Nailed it.
Say that just like he did. How about you, Nava?
And I am NavaBear. You can find me on Twitter and Twitch at NavaBear. And then on YouTube, you can find me at NavaBear Plays. And I do more than just Destiny there.
Yeah, go check them out. You're doing some Horizon Zero Dawn right now, yeah?
Horizon Zero Dawn, finishing up Mass Effect 3, and then still playing Destiny.
Sweet.
A little bit less than everything else right now, but I'll be back to more Destiny content here shortly.
Nice. Yeah, so hit them up for sure, guys. You can also find RezoCast on Twitter at RezoCast. We'd love to hear from you guys anything about Destiny, especially whatever's dropping tomorrow. We'd love to talk about it. And Hove, where can they find more about Resolute?
You can find Team Resolute on Twitter at Team Resolute and on Twitch at twitch.tv/ResoluteGaming7.
Okay, well, I guess that's it for this episode. It's been great having y'all here who've been listening live, and for you listening on iTunes and YouTube, Google Play, we really appreciate you guys. Drop us a review, leave us a like. Thanks so much, guys. Until next time, GG.
GG.
Well, I want to add on a question to that, and I just forgot what it was. Dang it! No, what was it? It had to do what were we just talking about before Hope
Destiny?
Interrupted there?
I think it'll definitely be closer to that, you know, than it was now, because you know we know that they were having trouble fitting. They were having trouble fitting things in. into the game.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so much trouble. Just couldn't get it in there.
Just not hold down the trigger and be able to get those range, like knowing that you can just hit it once and it's going to get that range really far away, is so nice right now.
I prefer to hit it a few times though. What's your favorite hit get in Lego? I don't know if you've noticed, if you listen, there aren't any more of me swearing and saying fuck because I fucked something up in the bloopers anymore.
Pove, where can they find you?
Same places, I think. I wasn't actually listening to you, sorry.
Same, you can find you at Lego. And Hove, where can they find more about Resolute?
Twitter. at Team Resolute. And also on Twitch.
He was not prepared for that at all.
I completely forgot. Reading chat is hard.